Thousand Oaks, California. We play in the SCIAC Conference. Some of the teams that we play that you guys might have heard, just so you get familiar with our brand of football. USD, we play USD, they're not in our conference. Of course, they're one double leg, but we go ahead and play those guys. We try to keep a rivalry, every year. Play teams like University of Redlands, Laverne, Claremont, Mud Scripps. Fine conference and some good football. But that's kind of where I'm from. It's in, again, it's in Thousand Oaks. It's a beautiful area in Ventura County. Okay. What I wanted to do today was I wanted to talk about defending the wing T. Now, I'm going to talk about the 4-4 defense as an instrument in which to do that. Now, I'm not going to get up here and feed you guys any type of bull or anything, because I'm telling you, if I were to choose a defense, if I were to start this thing from the top to defend the wing T, I probably wouldn't use the 4-4, okay? It's not the best defense to go out and fight these wing T guys, all right? Just because you can get outflanked so much. But it's the defense that we run, so it's the defense we're going to use. I think one of the principles that we're going to talk about here eventually.
Excuse me, just real quick, from Take the Knee, we like to thank Dave Aranda for coming all the way down from Kowloon and being able to, he got stuck in the traffic in Los Angeles for 3 hours, so I just want to say thank you, David, for coming out here and being part of the Take the Knee Cinco de Mayo deal. I got your shirt right here. Here it is. If it doesn't fit, give it back because it fits me. Okay?
Thank you so much.
All right. Go get them, Dave.
We'll get it. We'll have some fun. Again, 4-4 probably wouldn't be your number one choice, okay? Because you can get outflanked. And that's one of the principles of defending the one, not to get outflanked, not to get kicked out of any of the gaps, the eight gaps that you're given. I'd probably go with 50. All right. But the thing is, another principle of defending the wing T is you don't change your defense in a week. Okay. And so we're going to use the keys and the adjustments that we have within our defense to defend this offense that we all know and hate. Okay. So what I want to do, starting off, is give you a progression. Talk about our philosophy. Talk about our base 4-4 package. And then get into the adjustments we make in defending the wing T. All right. So I'll take you through step by step. Some of the things, just in terms of philosophy, where we come from with our guys. Okay. We want to make it known to them that attitude is everything. We talk about with our guys that you have to respect your opponent. I've been around places and I've heard other people speak where you get this do or die attitude when you're up on it's a Friday night or it's a Saturday afternoon and it's all or everything, win or nothing. And we try to get away from that as much as we can. Because I think what you get with that is you get a lot of bloodlust, you get a lot of anger and piss and vinegar and fire. And you tell me what happens when something goes wrong, right? Everything falls apart. There's no foundation. St. Augustine once said, anger is the weed, hate is the tree. Nothing comes good from, I think nothing is beneficial coming from anger, right? Whether it's on the football field or on the streets. Try to get away from that. So what we do is we try to sell to them that the team you're playing or the guy you're playing is you, right? And fundamentally, guys, the marksman aims at himself, okay? In other words, say for example, we're talking about a pitcher throwing a baseball. All right, that pitcher is going to work on his mechanics, going to work on the windup. Okay, he's going to work on the exit, the release, all the things that he can control. Yes, once that ball leaves his hands, it's in somebody else's hands now. Very much the same can be said as a football team, giving it your very best effort and doing everything that we can practice throughout the week. Then come Friday night, come Saturday night, somebody else's hands now. You give your best effort, but whatever the score comes out to be, the ships fall where they may, okay? And so, to get into that a little bit more, here we are with defending the wing T. We talk about the definition of a Kingsman, okay? I want to just go through this really quick. This is awfully neat, guys. We came up with this in 96, the very first year that our staff was together. And this is up on our wall. All of our guys know this, okay? When they come in as recruits, we talk about this, and then By the time the end of their freshman year, they know it. You better believe it. We talk about being a defender and champion of noble principle, being a skilled warrior, always prepared for battle, and traveling with a brotherhood, where the group is more important than the individual. sell that to them as much as possible.
Right.
Let me make one point here, and then we'll move on. I think this is important.
Okay.
I think as football coaches, we all talk about goals. Is that right? I think very a lot of us have goal boards. Do we not? As a defense, don't allow over 100 yards rushing. Don't allow over 300 yards total offense.
Right.
These types of things. I think what you have to ask yourself is, what are your kids playing for? Are they playing for your goals? What are they playing for? You know, I don't have the opportunity to watch a lot of TV. Got to watch the Laker game yesterday. It's kind of fired up about that. But when I do watch TV, I try to watch things like, you know, Discovery Channel and History Channel, stuff like that. A couple weeks back on Discovery Channel, they were doing a documentary on World War II, and they were talking about pilots, American pilots, flying over Germany. They were bombing pilots. They were bombing Germany. This is Nazi Germany during World War II. It turned out that these missions were very, very dangerous. One out of four did not come home. One out of four missions failed. So what this is saying is, if you went out three times and brother, you're going out your fourth time, odds are not very good. You're coming back that night. Okay? Everybody knew this. Okay? And it was a horrible, horrible death because of the anti-aircraft fire up top. You get shot down, and it would take 5 minutes, all right, to hit the earth. Back in these days, they did not have, you know, the cockpit and the parachutes where you can fly out. Can you imagine? Right on down. But when one of these missions would fail, there'd be 100, 200 guys with their hands up saying, "I'm next. I want to go." Now, right away, that caught me off guard. I'm going, why? Where is this coming from? They asked these guys. Now, you know, they're 70 and 80, 90 years old now. Why would you do this? And at first they said, well, you know, I'm bleeding red, white, and blue. And I'm doing it for my American flag. Some of them said, you know, I freaking do anything I can, anything in my power, to freaking kill those Nazis, kill the Germans. Okay. But what they found was that these were artificial answers, and only on the surface. When they dug deeper, man, what they found was that these guys, no older than the players you're coaching now, for the most part, these guys wouldn't let their buddies down. Do you hear me? All right. The kid that went up 2 weeks ago and succeeded and has gone up eight times and has beat all the odds, I'm going up because of him. Because he knew in that fourth time odds weren't good, but he still went. And now they're calling me for the first time. I'm going to say no, hell no. I'm not going to let him down. Or my brother, who I played catch in the backyard since I was a little kid, and who followed me into the army, and now went up the first time and was shot down and killed. I'm going to go up for him. Okay. They did it for each other. That's huge. That's important. So I think we have to realize that as coaches and develop that type of culture. You know what I'm saying? If it's a fourth and one and you're asking your middle linebacker to stuff that fullback because he knows the ISO is coming, you're not going to do it, man, because on your goal board back in your office, you say allow no fourth down conversions. All right? He's going to do it because he doesn't want to let his buddies down. So as coaches, I think you have to develop that type of atmosphere. Right? Create it. Right? And bring it up, I guess. Okay. Does that make sense? So we talk about being confident, courageous, disciplined, loyal, most dangerous when challenged, all these things. Okay. This right here, guys, is our base defense versus a base offense. Okay? So what we talked about, coming from left to right here with the tight end, we have a stud or a seven technique on the inside eye of the tight end. He's a C-gap player. He's a one-gap player. We have a three technique. We either go with a G or a shade, okay? Either go with a G or a shade, and then we have a five technique. So, this is what we're talking about with our defensive linemen. Okay, they're one-gap players, right? Get up the field, penetrate, attack. We talk about HIC, get your hat in the crack, right? Without get-off, man, nothing works. But at the same time, even though they are a one-gap player, in reality, they're playing two gaps. Here's what I mean. You've got your primary gap, man, but you also have your squeeze gap. Okay? Your Your squeeze gap is your adjacent gap. I'm telling you all this because all this is going to apply to our wing T defense. Here's what I mean. Okay. First thing we tell him is, say for example, the stud, he's a C-gap player. This right here is not a C-gap. Right? He's not playing that. He's playing this. That's the C-gap. This three technique, he's playing this B-gap. That isn't his B-gap. The B of the neck of the guard, that's his B-gap. The nose guard, he's playing that. That's his A-gap. No, it's not. That's his A-gap right here. The B of the neck, this thing right here. All right? Wherever that goes, that's your gap. Okay? This five technique, defensive end, that's his C-gap. No, that's the C-gap. Okay? And so what we're saying is with that, if we get a down block here, we don't want this defensive end getting up here, do we? Is that a C-gap? No. That's a C-gap. Isn't that right? We want him doing this, okay? And coming underneath. Here's what we're talking about with squeezing. Let's say if we get some type of a reach here on our three technique, okay? What our three technique wants to do is penetrate, play his primary gap. Is that right? You want him right up here, okay? All right, he wants to attack and penetrate. At the same time, what he doesn't want to do, okay, if I'm a three technique and here's my guard and he's coming to reach me, here's my tackle, here's my tight end. What he doesn't want to do is swivel his hips to the outside. He's playing his primary gap, but he has lost his squeeze gap. You guys understand that? Okay? And the zone schemes today, which are so prevalent today, that back is taught one of two things. Either read the defensive lineman in an inside zone, read the defensive lineman over the guard, or read that back. Okay? Or read the linebacker over the guard. Is that right? Okay? So as a three technique, if I'm playing that guard, and I get my hips in the hole, right? I'm playing my B gap, where's that back going to cut it up? The A gap. Okay? You just created or enlarged a cavity. This is going to be taken advantage of. Here's what I mean. Okay? So if we're getting something like this right here, okay, he wants to penetrate and knock this guard back, right? Instead of, say, taking on a guard with a push and a pull, two pushes. Lock those arms out and walk him back. Okay? Squeeze this gap right here. Right? So now our Mike backer can come over the top in a condensed gap. Right? Don't widen it out. Where this back has a huge cavity to run through. Does everybody understand that? Okay? You have a primary gap, you have a squeeze gap. Okay? That's all we're talking about with our rushman. Alright. Okay? With our linebackers, our inside backers, we talk about the ABCs, the fundamentals. Very simply, they're number one, hit and shed. Okay? There's two types of bases when you hit and shed. Okay? We talk about bases with your feet. There's the correct base. There's the opposite foot and shoulder base, and then there's the pancake base. Let me show you really quick, simply what this means. If you stand up real quick. Okay. Again, all of this stuff applies. All right. Let's say, for example, that I'm a linebacker and I'm taking on you as an O-lineman. Okay. And I'm playing right here. This is my gap. All right. And you're coming to block me. Now, if I take you on, okay, with this foot up, My play side foot, or my hip, my strike side foot back, and my strike side shoulder up, okay? What I want you to do now is put pressure on me and try to turn me out. Turn me out. See that? I'm going to try to stay and hold my ground as much as I can. Try to turn me out. Turn me out. All right. Now, I want to have my strike side shoulder up, my strike side foot up. Now push me and try to turn me out. Is there a difference?
Yeah.
There's a difference. Do you see what I mean? Every time, guys, your linebackers take a gap, like say, for example, it's a belly, all right? It's a belly iso to the weak side. That linebacker's going to take a gap. If he is getting used by that fullback, if he's getting turned out 99.9% of the time, man, he's taking on that fullback with this foot up, this shoulder up, and this foot back, and he's getting turned out. Okay, that's huge. That's important. All right, so we talk about hitting with a correct shoulder base right here, okay? This is opposite foot and shoulder base. This is what you do not want. Pancake base is when you're trying to get that foot down and you're on me and I'm on my butt, okay? That's a teaching tool. We tell them, hey son, you're within a split second of making this thing work. You want to get that foot in, sink your ass, and drive right through. Does that make sense?
Thank you.
Okay? So with a hit shed, we talk about the bases. That's important. Okay? With the hands, everything that you guys already know, elbows in, thumbs up, that type of thing. But it all starts with your base. Okay? Number two of the linebackers, we talk about pursuit. Now with pursuit, we have focal point pursuit. Focal point pursuit on the back. All right? For example, if this back is outside, this buck backer for us, okay, is going to work to that back's inside peck. Okay? If this back happens to be inside, this buck backer for us is going to work to that running back's near side peck. Always working a squeeze. So, for example, he is working to the near side peck. The mic backer here is working to the inside peck. And we have a squeeze. Okay? What you see here is more or less a triangle. Anytime we get run to the tight end, or three technique side, they're running into the teeth of our defense in a 4-4. Can you see that? Can you see that triangle? Mm-hmm. Okay, they're running right to the three technique. This gives our three technique a free go on this guard. Penetrate, get up the field. All of the trash will be taken out by the linebackers here, filling off the side, right? Because we're working focal point pursuit and we're working a squeeze. Does that make sense to everybody? Okay. All right. Our linebackers here, we give them techniques. This buck backer here is a 91 player. So if we've got flow coming this way, okay, the backers are going to read guard to backs, all right? So if the guard's working this way with flow coming this way, this buck backer is a 9-gap player, the 9-gap being right here, okay? So he is a 9, all right? The mic backer, he is a 31 player. So with flow going away from the mic backer, right, with guard, with a guard step away and backs away, he is heading to the 1-gap. This is the 1-gap. 1-3-5-9. 1-3-5. Okay? Flow going the other way. Okay? Buck backer is a 91 player. Work to the 1-gap. Buck Mike backer, work to the 3-gap. Everybody see that? They're 2-gap players, 1-gap on flow. Okay? 1-gap on flow. Reading from the guard to the near back. Anybody have any questions with that? Anyone have questions with that? A principle, guys, to the tight end side, which is relevant, and which you'll see in the wing tee sometimes. Okay, we call it the swinging gate. Okay, anytime, man, this is important. You might want to write this down. Anytime you have a C-gap player as a down lineman, he has got to penetrate, and number one, of all things, hold the freaking point. He can't get washed down. He has to hold the point, okay? What we're saying is, if we got run coming this way, okay? This stud, let's say, for example, we're getting some type of reach block here, just like that. This stud has to hold the point right here. He can't get washed by. Penetrate. Hold the point. Our rover here, who we're going to get to with our inverts play 4x4 in man line of scrimmage. All right, they do three things. They force, they fill, and they fold. That's all they do. Force with play coming to them. What they want to do is squeeze or constrict the running lane. Right? So what we're saying is, what this rover does not want to do is this. Can anyone tell me why? Why doesn't he want to come up and force a play like that?
He can get kicked out
very easily, can't he?
Yeah.
Okay? What he wants to do is come at a 45-degree angle, 2 yards behind the hip of the play side lineman, right here, and squeeze and constrict that running lane. Okay. If you ever talk to those offensive guys, right, when they run tight inside plays, they always draw this guy doing this. Yeah. All the way. All right.
Perfect setup for him.
Right. All right. So what we want to see is this. Okay. And he's going to hold that point right there. Okay. And now in base defense, we are going to cross shoulder any first level offender, okay? And near arm any second level defender. All right. First level defender being a pulling guard, a pulling tackle, pulling center, okay? Second level offender being a fullback. Make sense? Okay. You see that cavity right there? Right here? That's a swinging gate. Here's one post. Let me just draw it. See that right there? And this thing can open and close that way. Okay? This right here, this point, that's the 7 technique. This right here, that's the invert, that's the rover. We want the play funneled through the swinging gate. Who's going to close the gate? The buck backer.
Right.
Day number one, first thing we tell them is, you're a bonus player to the tight end side. Your job is to close that gate. All right. That's a principle that's going to hold. All right. Okay. Our inverts again. Flow coming to them. They're going to force. Okay. Flow going away from them. Okay. So flow's going away this way. They're going to fold. Just right here. Okay. We call it open door technique. Right. Look for that first open door. We just call these doors. Is it open or closed? All right. They want to be looking through the door to the ball carrier shoulders. All right. Why? Okay. Let's see now. If I'm a back, let's say if you're an invert and I'm a back, the play's going this way. If my if you can see my back numbers, there's not a big chance of cutback here. All right. If there's somewhat of a 45 degree tilt to my shoulders, there's a chance of a cutback now. Okay. So what we try and get them is key the tilt of the shoulders of the running back. All right. Is it here? All right. Now we can giddy up a little bit. All right. You know, in a wing tee, you still have to look out for reverse and that type of thing coming back. All right. So this, you can see we have to kind of highlight some things when we play the wing tee as opposed to normal offense. All right. But if the shoulders are anywhere downhill or 45 degree angle, we want you to play heavy in that B gap. Okay. So we're expecting a cutback. All right. Okay. And then the fill technique is when the play's inside. Say, for example, with this hawk, if the running backs are inside, he now holds true. He holds true. He patterns his feet right here. Why? Two things are going to happen. Either one, they're going to cut us, and the ball's going to declare right upfield. Or two, we get some type of cross shoulder, say it's a trap or whatever it is, and the ball does what? Bounce outside. Are you with me? Okay. If the ball cuts us right upfield, this turns into what type of technique? What is that right there? That's the fold. Are you with me? That's the fold. If it cuts us, the fill technique becomes the fold. Okay? If we get some type of cross shoulder, the ball now bounces, and the fill technique now becomes the what? The force. Does that make sense to everybody? Okay, so the fill technique is a combination, an either or, of the fold or the force. Did I confuse anybody with that? Okay. So in the fill technique, they just hold true. Okay. Okay. With our secondary now, we play a lot of bump and run, man to man. Okay. At 8-man front, we have a huge pressure package. We want those corners up in the face. Play feet open, hands. Right. Try to jam the release at the start. Okay. With that free safety, what we try to do is, of course, always keep him free as a deep middle third player playing contentious of quarterback. One of the coverages that we do run that I imagine you might be getting into in an 8-man front is a robber coverage. You guys play that much at all? Okay. And that coverage, the corners, we play this versus the wing tee, the corners are invert half one players. Okay. They're going to invert half over the top of number one. Their job is PTP, protect the post, right? There's no one in there for the post, man, but the number one receiver, that's your job. Get over the top of him, protect the post, okay? The free safety here is robbing down to the passing strength side, number two receiver, who happens to be this guy, okay? It's basically quarters rules from there, okay? If that number two runs a vertical, free safety mans him up. If that number two, okay, runs an in, within 8 yards, he looks for number one. That number two runs an up and an in at 8 to 10 yards, the free safety then mans up the tight end. All right? There's quarter rules. Okay? But it's a way for us to get that free safety involved from a 9-man front. Okay? It's kind of a base intro into our defense. All right. Wing tee basic principles. Now, I'm not going to go over. Now, how many of you guys see the wing tee? Just about everybody. Are there any offensive guys in here learning on how to, what defense they're trying to do to you? Is that right? Okay. What you need to do, I think number one, is find out what type of wing tee are they, okay? These are basic principles, all right, that every wing tee, the traditional wing tee is going to have. That's what I'm going to talk about, traditional wing tee, okay? If you're saying something else, maybe after we're done, bring it up, we can talk about it. Okay? You'll see how some of these principles apply. You got me? But in the traditional wing T, I'm talking about fullback, halfback, tight end, wing, okay? They've got four wide receivers, more or less, they can hit you right now and cut you. Okay? Right? The QB can threaten the flank to either side with action to or away. Now, in the wing T, the quarterback does not have to be a runner, but damn it, man, he's tough to defend if he is. Okay? In the wing T, as far as I'm concerned, the toughest thing to defend is that option. Okay? Because all the wing T guys is a numbers game. And again, we'll show you our 4-4 defense and how we stack up against it. But realize this, with the wing T, man, whoever has the pin last is going to win. Okay, on the board. Bottom line. Okay? All right? If you feel, or your partner down the street feels, that they have a defense that can defend everything in the wing T, then they don't know about the school across the way that just came up with this new play. Right? They don't know about that play yet. All right? That's kind of how it goes. Okay? Whoever has the pin last is going to win. All right? All three backs are close enough to formation so they can be used as blockers, ball carriers, or for deception. All right? So say, for example, with that halfback. Right, that split inside, okay? He can be aligned as a halfback, where now he has a chance now to insert up on the linebacker for the belly, can he? Okay, they can also align him up as a wing, right? It'd be double slot now. And now he has a chance for what? Say, like on any type of sweep coming to him, he can get out and arc that linebacker that way, all right? What we see sometimes is that a wing, short motion back, get to the halfback spot, and then load you up with an ISO. Okay, I'm going to see that too. So you have to know that. But these are basic principles again. The offense, guys, is best described as sequence football. Does everybody understand that? What that is? It's a chess match. Okay. For example, if you're seeing a traditional wing T team and you're getting a lot of sweep to that tight end side, all right, you have to know what these guys are thinking. In other words, if you over adjust to the tight end wing side, okay, for the sweep, what are they going to do backside to cut you? Alright? Is it going to be the reverse, the counter? You know? Is it going to be the belly option? What's it going to be backside to cut you? You have to know that. You have to plan ahead. Does it make sense? Okay? Alright? It's sequence football. And there's a balance of passing. And what we found is that teams are running a wing T for a reason, because they can't pass the football. Okay? And so what we're going to do is just man them up. Alright? And we have some simple, we have like some call we call jam three, which I can show you. Because a lot of times that one receiver they want to get to is that split end receiver, okay, to the open side. And we'll put someone in his face and put cover three behind it, all right, and like a passing downs, okay. Philosophy of attack is based on taking advantage of adjustments the defense must make to compensate for the wing's flanking angle. Everyone understand there's eight gaps now we're talking about, right? It's just like it's double tight, man, right? So you need to defend eight gaps. That's what they do to you. Okay. All right, this is what we're talking about with the wing T. Here's how we're going to align to it. Okay. Our seven technique is no longer now a seven. Okay. We call it a six. He's head up on that tight end. Okay. What his job is, and we'll get into it later, is he wants to not allow that tight end to release off to that inside backer. Okay. Now, there's two ways we can play the stud. Okay. There's two ways. We can either have him play the C gap or the D gap. Okay. If he plays the D gap, and more or less, he becomes a nine technique, right? But he lines up in a six. So he's playing a nine from a six. We call that echo. Echo, okay? Echo means from a six, he plays a nine. So in other words, if he gets a base block, he's going to work his hips to the outside, right? Stay in his gap, okay? If we want that stud, right, playing the C gap, all right, we just call it stud. Stud, that's where he normally lines. But he's going to play that from a six. Everybody understand that? Okay, all right, and we can switch that on and off as we wish, all right. So it's going to be called in the huddle, man. So if there is no call, it's an automatic echo. The call might be strong G stud, cover three. Now he knows from a six he's playing a C gap responsibility. Does that make sense? Okay. Then we're still going to have a three technique. We're still going to have a G. Going to have a Y five. One of the principles is, and we'll talk about it in a little bit, we're going to press the wing with our rover. It's going to walk up, get right in that wing's face, right now. We're not going to play soft, right? For example, say with a sweep or something, we're not going to allow them, right, to get those angles they want to get. No way, all right? With our linebackers now, If you remember from our base defense, we had them adjusted over the tight end. We're not going to center them up. They're playing 30 techniques. Still playing the same thing, playing from the guard to the near back. Okay? Corner here, corner right here, he's going to be 1x8. Okay? Outside of that wing, free safety is going to be about 8-7 yards, line up on the outside edge of the offensive strong guard. And our corner here, more or less, will be in man coverage. Alright? And our base stuff. Okay. Here we go. When you break things down, man, alright, you need to know what the wing T does. What does your wing T do? What you're going to see. Alright? You need to break it down. What I would do, okay, is I would take a line and I would go right through the center's butt. Okay? With no motion. With no motion, where are they running the football? And this is traditional wing T right here. Okay? With no motion, where is that ball going? Okay? So we're saying 80% of the offense will attack the tight end wing with no motion. How's it going, man? Okay? All right? So we can still see the buck sweep. Okay? We can see some type of option. All right? We can see a key pass. Most likely, we'll see if you're talking about traditional wing T, you'll probably see the down series. Okay? You can see some trap, of course, some gut, you know, and then some belly to the backside. Okay? No belly option, though, really. All right? And then, of course, you know, wing T teams are getting more into three-step passing games now. Does everybody see that? Okay? That's with no motion. So now, these guys know what they're playing. These guys know what they're playing. That end knows, with no motion, if I get a fan block, who plays it? It's the belly, right? Stay outside edge and push them up the field, right? Constrict, squeeze your gap. Remember what we talked about? This is his primary gap, is that right? Where's his squeeze gap? Squeeze that freaking gap, because the play's going right in there. Make sense? He knows that with no motion. It's the only thing he's seeing. Okay? You gotta break it down. Alright? Now we got motion. Now things change. Alright? Now 80% of the offense is directed to the open side. Okay? Of course, this being the open side. Alright? So again, we got waggle back. We've got counter coming back. Okay? You still have your trap games. But now, with that type of motion, okay, from what we see in the traditional wing T, we're playing the belly, okay, playing the belly option. Because versus a 4-4, you have to defend the belly option, okay, because they hurt you with numbers, all right? And of course, you got your sweep and those things, all right? But again, you cut it in half, all right? You cut it in half, and they have to know who's playing what. I forgot one thing. Let me go back to it. All right. You know, it's a numbers game, man. It's a numbers game. So what we do is, all right, we say within the tackle box, we need four guys. We need four guys versus the wing T in the tackle box to defend their trap, their guts, everything they want to do in the inside running game. Okay? So our four guys are right here. Tackle, nose, Buck, and Mike. That's your four. Okay? We're going to say from the tackle out, all right, tackle, tight end, wing, we also need four guys. Right? And with no motion, right, they're going to attack that tight end wing side. Okay? If you draw it up and you count the lead blocker, right, you count the secondary blocker, maybe you count the quarterback and the running back, they'll have at least four guys. You need to have four there also. Make sense? Okay? So right now, you know, in a 4-4, we've only got three. But since this buck is reading this guard's going to pull, we're counting the buck. All right? As long as, all right, as long as we get a block down from our tackle, now we're going to be all right with numbers, okay? And to the backside, from the tackle out, we only need three guys, all right? We need three guys. We have our end, our hawk, and our corner there that satisfy that requirement, okay? All we did, guys, was we drew up the plays, right, from the tackles out and the tackles in, and said how many hats they got here. We need to have at least as many hats. Okay. So much of defending the wing T is aligning up properly to it. Right. Do not get outflanked. You see the same here. All right. Questions they ask about the wing T. Are they wing T or are they wings and things? Right. The wing T we see are wings and things. So we wing T one series. Spread, shotgun, the next series. Okay, you know what you got. What are their base formations? Okay, talk about unbalance a little bit. Do they run any unbalance? Do they run any of the double wing? Right, will they motion from the double wing to the traditional, right? And come back. Will they ISO you up in the belly off of that, all right? Are they fullback or halfback oriented team? If they are, take that sucker away. Is that right? Okay, if they are a fullback team, take the belly away. Okay, take the down series away. Force them to sweep the ball. In other words, gut it up. Get all your guys, put them in the box, and say, we're not going to allow you to run inside. Right? If that halfback's not a player, if in high school, if he's a 5'6", have them run the freaking sweep. Make sense? And that safety from the back side will run his ass down. Okay? Make them beat you left-handed. Are they a four running back team? Is that quarterback a runner? If he is, you better plan to have a hat for him. Okay? What type of imbalance? Do they run back against motion? Now, the wing T, you see, guys, do they run back against motion? You see it?
Once in a while.
With a counter or something coming back?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, they do. If they don't, right? If they don't, we just call orbit dogs, right? So, say the tight end wing, that wing comes in motion, okay? I want the backer to display inside to blitz because you know the play's going there, right? Nothing's coming back, all right? So you have to see that through film study, right? Do they run back against motion? If they don't, that motion can be an automatic blitz for you right now, okay, into where they're running, all right? What type of option? Is it a veer option, okay? Is it a down option? That's tough. Is it speed option? What is it, okay? And we talk about it. Is there a running back you must stop? Defending the wing tee, learn from experiences. We talk about this, know what to defend. We talk about this in the very beginning. Know and adjust. The defense that you use to defend the wing tee with the keys that you use, okay? This is awfully important, guys. Coach up the scout team. So much of it is timing. You have a week to prepare these guys. If they're the team to beat in your conference, it's not just a week, it's an entire season. Is that right? If you're playing them week 8, and you don't see wing tee until week 8 in camp, you're coaching up your scout offense how to run the wing tee so your defense can be geared up to stop them come week 8 if that's the team you need to beat. All right? There's a 10-minute period. And it's Rialto week. If Rialto runs the wing tee, right? You don't need a lot of change. You don't need a lot, guys, because of so much. Because depending on the wing tee you see, they can do so many different things. You have to adjust to everything they do. So you got 4 different defenses to go on the wing tee. Then what? That's 8. What? 16 different adjustments you have to make. That's too much. All right? Do not get outflanked. Do not get kicked out any of the 8 gaps. Keys without the ball. Don't practice the whole practice without the ball. We have certain periods where you can key without the ball so your guys can know what their assignment is. And we want to be able to press the wing, and you better believe you can blitz these guys because penetration kills it. All right, this is what we see with unbalance. Any of you guys see unbalance? Okay, we see this. We're still going to have, see the numbers up top? All right, we're still going to keep the same numbers, okay? All right, because we still think that we can get that buck over on the sweep, all right? If that tackle blocks down our 3 technique. That becomes huge in how we play our 3 technique. All right? If that tackle, say on the sweep, is not blocking down our 3, say for example with a 3 if we're only playing trap, you guys, C-teams, or do any of you guys just play trap with your tackles? You know what I'm talking about? Like say if the guard pulls outside, we do this a little bit, I'm going to get into it. Guard pulls outside, a lot of teams will just do this. Still play trap. You know what I mean? They'll still do that. What happens now is, you got to know if the offense you're going to see does this, they won't block this guy anymore. There's no need to. Mm-hmm. Now your numbers game is screwed on the sweep. You have to know if they do that or not. And if they do, you got to plan for it. So what we basically see, when we see, okay, unbalanced, we're thinking buck sweep to the tight end wing side. All right? Okay. Here we go. Now we're going to get it. What we'll do, guys, is I've broken it down. You know, we got 3 technique, we got nose, we got backers, we got inverse, we got everybody. I'm going to go through the whole thing with you, okay, step by step. Now here's the thing. I'm going to tell you this now, okay? What I love about clinics is this. You know, there's an old Zen saying. There's a Zen master who welcomed a university professor into his house in Japan. University professor wanted to come in and learn about some Zen. Okay? Professor came in, and the Zen master shook his hand. How you doing? They sat down. They started discussing Zen. But right away, that university professor was saying, yeah, we got this. Well, in some ways, we got this too, but ours is a little bit better. We've always had that. You guys know what I'm talking about? That type of conversation. You guys had that type of conversation before with somebody? And what eventually happened is that it was time for tea. It was tea time. So that Zen master got out a teapot and started to pour himself some tea, and then went to the university professor and started to pour him some tea. And the cup became full, but he kept on pouring. And he kept on pouring. And it was spilling all over the place. And eventually the university professor goes, what are you doing? The cup is full. It's overflowing. What are you doing? And the Zen master put down the teapot and said, well, you see, like this teacup, you too are full of your own opinions and speculations. How can I teach you Zen if you first don't empty your cup? Does that make sense? All right. That's what I love about clinics, is you can go and you can sit down, and you can get up and you can talk. I'm learning from you guys too. But you can empty your cup and take in something entirely new. And see how can we make this thing work. Right? Can it fit us? Will it fit us? All right. With our three technique, he's going to key the nape of the neck of the guard to the near back, to the fullback. All right. The three technique must be able to counter four different blocking schemes. This is what's important right here. You might want to write this down. The key progression is man on, near back, backside lineman. Okay. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. We've got some free techniques that can do this, but we've had some that can't. And if they can't, then that's fine. We'll adjust it. But this is how we're going to teach it. And when we teach it, we don't make a big deal out of it. All right? We don't say, this is the cornerstone of our defense. If you don't get this, you're screwed. We're screwed. Do or die. We stay away from that. All right? But what we're trying to do, man, by keying the nape of the neck to the near back, is we're trying to get a squeeze to either side, right? And I'm gonna show you what I mean, okay? With the trap, down block equals trap for that three technique. It's very simple. Down block, you cross shoulder right now. Okay, it could be the guard, could be the tackle, like on a counter, okay? Could be the tackle on a counter, on tackle trap, all right? Down block, squeeze, trap, okay? Influence trap, how do we defend that, okay? That three technique is going to read the nape of the neck of the guard. Anytime that guard pulls the tight end wing side, the three technique gets his eyes on that back right now. If the back is midline, right, he works back inside. If that back is off midline, okay, for example, right here, we work outside. He's reading the near back. All right. So if we're here, sweep, he's midline, work inside. Knock off the backside puller, okay? You need to have numbers. Let me show you what I mean. Okay. All right, when the offensive guard pulls across the center face, the free technique will use the rib elbow. So we get this right here, and we're gonna get that right there. We wanna get that right there. Let me show you what rib elbow is. Stand up real quick. Okay, we use this with our linebackers, with our we call them rushmen, we don't call them D-linemen. Right. D-linemen sounds like you're holding something back. Bullshit, we're going to go and get it, it's a rushman. Right. And we use it for a pass rush. Okay. So what I want to do is, let's say if I'm a three technique here, and you're a center here. Okay. Actually, it might be better if we get this way. All right. And my guard going across your face, okay, and I'm going to be here, I'm going to go one, two, you're coming to get me. What I want to do is I want to be able to feel this, all right? My B gap has gone away, hasn't it? Remember we talked about the B gap has gone away? I want to start veering in that direction. I want to rip right here, okay? I want to rip. Remember, none of this works if you don't have get off and you don't have your hat in the crack. My hat in the crack right now, it's in the gap, okay? And all I want to do is I want to turn my elbow out and run his hip, okay? The rip elbow is this to this. And turn his hip. All right. We don't teach in this pass rush. I know so many times you see this stuff, right? Work this up. Work your hand to the sky. Work it on up. We don't teach that. All right. Okay. So what happens? Say if I'm a defensive end, I'm rushing you as an offensive tackle. When you get this, you got to do what with this? You ever see guys run that way? okay? What we do is just take the shortcut, right? Rip elbow, turn that elbow out, and come right off his back. That's how we take on gear blocks, all right? Or down blocks. Okay. When the opposite guard block's down, three technique plays trap. We know that. Fan block, three technique will squeeze the gap, right? So we have our primary gap, we have our squeeze gap. Play the squeeze gap. Is that right? Okay. A fan block tells you the ball is inside. Okay. All right. When the offensive guard now pulls outside, okay, the three technique is going to read this guy right here. Okay. Because it's going to be really one of two things. He's either going to be midline or he's going to be 45 outside. That's all he's going to see. And we rep this till the cows come home. Okay, it has to be repped. Again, we got some guys that can do it, some guys can't. And when they can't, they're playing trap the whole time. All right, we're not going to get hit up the gut. Okay? All right? So if that guard pulls outside, our three technique wants the key, the nap of the neck to that fullback. If that fullback is heading midline, right, he wants to redirect inside and tackle that fullback. All right? It might be sweep. If it's sweep, he's getting a backside guard pull. He needs to create some havoc right here, so we're not counting that backside guard on the play side. It's a numbers game, right? If we lose our three technique and they gain a backside guard, okay, that's not good. All right, everybody see that? Okay. What we can also see though is that fullback is off the midline. Now we're talking what down? Probably the down game. All we want to do now, right, is water ski in that area. Does that make sense? What we're trying to do, guys, is this. Let me show you. Let's say for example, if it's an influence trap, okay, that free technique is not going to be able to cross shoulder that pulling guard. Everybody with me? Everybody see that? You're not going to be able to do it. No way. Okay. With the D line, we talk about steps. Okay. So if I'm here, okay, that first step is going to be an explosion step. Get a feel. That second step I'm going to take, right, with my gap foot is going to be a balance step. Get my foot in the ground, come to balance. My third step is my redirection step, either this way or that way. So realize that D-line is going to be taking at least three steps, all right? Then he's going to work to come and squeeze, or he's going to work to turn the corner. You got me? So what we're trying to do is decrease that cavity, all right, that we get with a guard pull, all right? So we want to be able to squeeze here and squeeze here. Right? So if they do trap us, they trap us here, not here if we're straight up the field. Does everybody see that? Do I make sense to everybody? We want to be able to squeeze the running lane either way. Okay? All right. Nose guard. Same reads. Okay? When the guard pulls, oops. When the guard pulls outside, same thing's happening. When the guard pulls outside, he wants to read this guy. Is he on the midline? If he's on the midline, we need to work back inside. Okay? Let's call that turn an inch. When you teach it, make sure their hand to the direction they're turning is on the ground. Right? Overemphasize it, right? Okay? So, example, if I'm trying to get off and that fullback is on the midline, get that hand on the ground and turn that point. Skim it right now. Right? These are all the redirections drill that we do with the D lineman every single day. Is that right? Those of you that coach defensive linemen. Alright? Okay. The fullback is off the midline. Now we're probably thinking what? What play are we thinking now? Probably belly. Probably belly, right? Again, what we don't want to do when you have your tackles just play trap is you don't want to increase that running lane. That's where the belly's going, isn't it? It's going in the B gap. Right, we don't see how much more this is increased here. If this guard has to block out, or I'm sorry, with the cross block belly, and this tackle has to block out. Does everybody see that?
Yeah.
I'd rather be here than here. Squeeze that sucker back. Rip elbow it back. Does that make sense? Okay. All right. Force them to base block it is what we're trying to do. All right. Now we get to our defensive ends. Okay, the stud now, remember now, he's going to be a six technique. We're expecting the tight end to block down the majority of the time. okay? But we found when we play six, Titan's going to treat us like you're a seven, all right, and try to block you down, okay? Because they want to get that flanking angle. They want to get to that extra gap that that wing provides them, all right? So let's say, okay, that we're, let's say, for example, that we're getting something like this, okay, and we're here, and we're here, all right? What we want to be able to do, okay, let's say, for example, that echo, all right, is our base technique. We want to be able to squeeze and constrict that tight end, all right, to where he cannot get a free release, to where we gain what? Who do we gain on the back? On the back side, behind us.
Oh, the linebacker.
The linebacker. We gain the linebacker now to the play side, all right? By squeezing and constricting the tight end, we can now cross shoulder, all right, any guard pulling to kick us out. Remember, one of the fundamental principles of Vane the Wing T is what? Not get kicked out in any of the eight gaps. Not getting kicked out, not one time. Not on trap, not on down, not on belly, not on anything. We're not getting kicked out. We're cross shoulder on everything, yes.
So if you take the guard out of the play, you have a better chance to stop it?
With the belly down?
Yeah.
We think we can. Here's another important part about cross shoulder, just real quick. When we're teaching this, okay? If you're coming to cross shoulder me and I'm here, right? What I want to be able to do with the cross shoulder is when I realize the down block, I want to bring my backside hand right off my hip. That's the key, okay? So in other words, go ahead and go back. Rush right there. So anyways, hold on tight. So if I'm getting up and my guy is down, what I don't want to do is do what? Do this, okay? I want to get my hand right off my hip, my backside hip. And so I'm in this angle right now. And if I'm coming to cross shoulder with you, what I want to do again is rip, and then what do you think I want to see right here? Rip elbow and get right back up the field, okay? We still want to be able to penetrate when we cross shoulder. We don't want to cross shoulder on line of scrimmage. We want to cross shoulder up the line of scrimmage. Make sense? And create a pop, all right? Rip elbow his butt and get back up, okay? Right there is what we're trying to do. All right, now let's say if it's a sweep, okay? If it's a sweep here and he's a little bit deeper and we're feeling the tight end and we're feeling the wing, what we want to be able to do is for that wing to block our stud. Remember playing an echo technique, right? Playing an echo. Get your hips to the wing, okay? If the wing blocks the stud, who blocks the play side backer? The tight end has to. And we got angles on the tight end now. Does that make sense to you? That's why you play six. That's why you do not play seven. All right? Okay, power sweep. Tight end blocks down and pullback attempts to kick out. We will cross shoulder that. All right? Defensive end. All right, 2 yards outside off the tackle, and we turn them in at a 45. All right, and I'm still figuring out the computer stuff here. We couldn't get this guy to get turned in 45. All right, now, is everybody understanding this stuff so far? Any questions on it? Nothing? If we get an offensive tackle block like a fan, we know it's what? Most likely. You know it's belly, in the B gap. Squeeze your squeeze gap, right? Play your primary gap, the outside arm free, squeeze it, build a wall. If the offensive tackle reaches, all right, so now if he reaches this way, okay, where's the C-gap now? Remember we talked about it?
Yeah.
There it is right there. Get upfield, right? Play that C-gap, okay? With a down block, now here's where it gets tricky. Okay. So we get something like this. This is where they get you. They get you on belly and they get you on waggle.
Okay.
These are the two types of actions you'll see from the guard. The first one being right here, when he's on the line of scrimmage, that's the kick out belly. Okay. Second one, where he's a little bit deeper, that's the waggle. We're not gonna coach our end to recognize the two. You know what I mean? We're gonna see belly all day long. All right. 12 bellies. First quarter. Second quarter. First play. What is it? Waggle. Are we able to diagnose that? No. He's not. So we don't tell him. So we're telling him to still cross shoulder. So pull up. Now contain the quarterback and give it to somebody else. Okay? So he's still cross shouldering and working upfield on that guard. Okay? Everyone understand that? Okay? You know, we've never tried. Hey, you diagnosed them. Don't worry about it. Don't do it. Because, I mean, what's waggle through a wing T offense? It's a first down play, isn't it? Right, make it look like run, and then hit him. It's a home run play, right? It's not a conversion. It's a home run play, okay? We want our guys playing trap, and we'll worry about the pull-up later. Any questions on that? Linebackers. Both backers are going to key the guard to the near side back, okay? This is pretty simple, guys. We'll flow two, and the guard pulling the buck will stack the stud right here, all right? And read whether it's an open or closed window, right? So if we have a stud playing a nine or echo technique, if the stud is playing this technique right here, the buck then is a what? He's a C-gap player. If our stud is playing a stud technique, if he's playing a seven, he's playing the C-gap here, our buck is now a what? A nine-gap player. So he will know that. So he will know if the call is stud in the huddle, he knows he's an alley nine-gap player. And he's doing what? Closing the gate. Is that right? Okay. Everybody can see this. Okay? So if we're getting this type of thing here, okay, with the guard pulling here, we want to have that, and we want to have that, and let's say if we get this, okay, that's sweet, all right? We're going to say what? That six is an echo technique. We're going to say what probably to that buck? What gap? We'll probably show you an open window right there. If our stud's doing a good job. See gap. Everybody see that? All right? If that stud is penetrating and kicking that tight end's butt and getting him up the field and not allowing a free release, that gives our buck backer a free run, running the C-gap to disrupt anything that's going on. Everybody see that? We still have a corner backside who's playing any type of spill. So we're allowed to do that with our buck. Let him go. Unleash him. Let him play. Okay? Every time we talk about linebackers, we're like, well, you have to key this, key that, key your guard, okay? Key the open windows. If it's open, hit it. If it's closed, scrape over top. All right? Let them play. Okay? If the guard, we get this and we get that right away, okay, our stud now, say he's an echo, hasn't done a good job, all right, now we have to do what? Scrape over top. The window is now closed. The window, guys, is this right here. Everybody see that? Okay? We'll flow away, okay? We're still going to key this guard, all right? Let's say if we get some here, all right, we want to look right here for the spot. That's the spot, directly behind the center. Any color coming to the spot tells us to redirect. Okay, we take color in the spot over the back's initial flow. Let's say a base block by our guard. Okay, what's usually going to happen is we'll see counter. All right, and counter this guard gives it away because he's down right now. Okay, with flow coming here, the buck knows that. Can work to stack the tackle, because the tackle's going to cross shoulder any tackle trap, the counter. All right? Any questions with that? Mike linebacker, same stuff. Mike linebacker is easier, because the B gap's right in front of him. That's his open and closed window. Okay? If it's open, hit it. It's closed, grip over top. In the belly. Okay? So we're getting loaded up with our fullback, or loaded up with our halfback, fullback over the top. The Mike wants to be able to take that, okay, inside, out. Hit it with his outside arm, okay? He wants to be able to bounce that thing outside, all right? Okay, everybody see that? And what's so important with that? We mentioned earlier, linebackers. Remember his base? Correct foot and shoulder base, okay? Don't get turned out. If you get turned out, what happens? Instead of being here, you're now here. The gap's that much wider, okay? With flow away, it's the same thing. He's keying the spot, anything coming back. Okay. Inverts, this is the toughest one to coach. Okay. And it's tough because this, and if you're an invert coach, you gotta know this. Alright? Wing T offense will go after the inverts. Why? Why do you think they go after those guys? Because the wing T is gonna go after the one guy, first thing they do. If you're sitting down in wing T offensive staff meeting, they're going to look at the tape and they're going to go, okay, which one of the 11 guys has dual responsibility? Which one of the 11 guys is living in two different worlds? You hear me? So we talk about these inverts, they're responsible for what? Force, right? They're also responsible a lot of times for what? The flat and pass coverage. You got me? All right. So they're responsible to be up here one play, but then way out here the other play. Okay, they're going to take advantage of you. All right. And work to kick you out, and work to literally just screw your head, all right? We gotta keep it simple for our inverts. So our rover aligns to the tight end wing side, all right? We wanna build a line on the wing and press them. Have some more time. What is the midline alignment? And you stand this way facing me. Okay, this is the wing, I'm the rover. He's gonna be off the line of scrimmage, okay? And inside plane alignment. Inside plane means my inside foot is along the inside heel of his inside foot. That's an inside plane. Everybody see that? Right here. Inside, this is what, how we teach our rushman or D lineman to line up. Midline plane means my inside foot is right down his crotch. That's where we want this guy lined up. And outside plane would be my inside foot is aligned on his inside heel right there. Everybody see that? So with the rover, we want him aligned right here, right in his face. Okay? That's what we want to see. All right. He's going to read the wing. Three things usually happen. Okay? If we get a down block, we're cross-shouldering. We're not getting kicked out. Remember, that wing adds an extra gap. We're not going to allow ourselves to get kicked out. Cross-shoulder that sucker. Make it bounce. We have a corner, right? 8 yards right here. 1 yard outside. Who's going to block him? Okay? We have a buck because the stud has done a great job keeping the tight end off, and the wing has to block the stud. The buck's a free runner. You got me? We've got numbers. Cross shoulder, make it spill. Don't get cut. Alright? Alright? That's with any down block. Okay? If we get an outside release from that wing, we're thinking pass right now. We're just gonna the feather off to the flat. Okay, we're thinking pass. We don't see a lot of outside releases from our wings. Alright. Short motion. Or motion will change everything. They gotta know that. Okay. Motion. Now I'm going to go over this in detail in the next slide. Okay. But motion, guys, our eyes automatically go down to the fullback. Two things are going to happen. Okay. If that fullback is working towards you at a 45-degree angle, blitz the freaking fullback. It's a waggle pass. It's Zach waggle pass. Okay. They want the fullback to come out underneath. He's going to be the intended receiver. Blitz him up. Okay, it's an automatic blitz with the fullback coming towards you. Okay, the fullback is midline or away. We now sink, looking for something coming back. Playing open door technique. Okay, so we got over this. The wing blocks down. We must squeeze, look inside to cross over anything that's coming back. The wing makes an outside release. We must collision and play the flat. If the wing goes in short motion, we have to look to the fullback. Okay. The fullback's coming towards us, blitz that sucker. It's blitz contained, right? So we're on the outside edge of that guy. We're not coming underneath him. If the fullback blitzes, we're coming on the outside. Blitz contained, all right? All right? Then we got an automatic blitz off the edge. If the fullback goes away or goes midline, we now sink. It's now your what? Remember we talked about at the very beginning? It's your what? Fill or full technique, isn't it? Open door. Open door player. All right. Here's your hawk. All right, the hawk has to know whether he has motion to him or not, okay? All right, with no motion, the hawk's gonna read the halfback, okay? If the halfback goes away, he's gonna look to the fullback. If the fullback comes to him, what play is that? 99.9% of the time. What play is it? It's waggle, right? If we get this, he goes away, and we get that coming back, that's waggle right now. That's your guy. Okay, we're giving the hawk the fullback on the waggle, okay? If the fullback and the halfback now both go away, right, he now does what? Plays fold technique looking for the wing coming back, okay? Motion to the hawk, now we change, okay? Motion to the hawk, so now we've got this coming back, all right? The hawk now wants to work up to stress the line of scrimmage, okay? He's playing now the motion man, okay? It's probably gonna be a pitch, right? Might be an option. You got the pitch guy, right? You're the sweep guy. Does that make sense to everybody?
So okay? The hawk has the quarterback or the?
The motion guy.
The motion guy.
The motion guy, right, okay?
Coach, sorry to interrupt real quick. Before you get finished here, on behalf of Southwest Fisher Football, I want to thank you for being here.
Oh, no problem, man.
Little certificate for you and a mug.
Oh, I could use this. Thank you.
Okay? Thank you for being here. We really appreciate it.
No problem. We'll have to ask these guys. I'm with you. All right. Everybody understand that? Is this simple stuff so far? It's simple stuff. Here we go. Secondary. I was going to talk about man. You want to talk about something else after we're done? I'll do it. All right? Man to man is a favorite. We're going to flip-flop corner. So everybody, now you guys got to find, if you're playing an eight-man front, you better have a corner that can run. At least one. He's your man coverage corner. All right? He lines to split inside and say, hey, you know what? You're man to man with this guy. Don't allow him to catch a pass. All right? Okay? You're going to have another, probably a physical corner. Say, hey, you're 1x8 off the that wing. You're playing now any spill. We call you the cleaner. You know what I mean? Did you guys see that movie, John Travolta was in it, Samuel Jackson? Pulp Fiction. You see Pulp Fiction? It's a great movie, man. It's a great movie. Remember what they had? They kill some guy, everything got messed up, everything was screwed up. And what'd they do?
Oh, yeah,
they spilled everything, they had to call who? The freaking cleaner. The cleaner had to come and clean everything up, sweep it up. That's what the corner does. Tight end weak side.
Well, the break the 8-man, he can wrap that.
Right. Well, he's the free guy.
Yeah.
In every run, you're gonna have a hit man, you're gonna have a free hitter. The hit man is probably your linebacker, the guy who's responsible for the gap. Your free hitter is the guy that they can account for when you get the ball to turn to. Alright? Okay? So strong corner, we know about this. Alright? The wing blocks down, you're expecting what? Run coming to you. Okay, wing blocks down, for the corner's gonna know down equals trap for the guy in front of him, the rover, the ball's gonna get spilled. Okay? Okay? Ring releases outside. All right, the corner's got the wing man to man. The wing goes in motion. This is where we shift our defense. We don't run with anybody. We shift it. All right. So if the wing goes in motion, this right here, the wing goes in motion. The free safety now plays the halfback. The corner now plays the tight end. That's where we get our extra hat and belly. In a 4-4, guys, you can't play the belly option without getting your free safety involved. I can tell you right now. And I tell you what, all the wing T freaking gurus, they know that too. They're gonna come get you. Okay, gotta get your free safety involved. No other way about it.
You get him closer to the line or what?
With this type of motion, he's clued in to this guy right here. So it's the robber technique. We're talking about robber technique,
yeah.
It's the same thing. He's keying this guy right now. That he's man on man with him. So if he starts working towards the B gap, he's a filler. The mic, in other words, fills it to him. So we need our end and our hog playing the option. The only way to do it.
You're still going
to have some corners. Right. Okay. So there's our free safety. Tight end blocks down. It's outside play sweep. Free safety in the alley. It's the extra half. Okay. Tight end releases. The free safety plays a man-to-man. Wing goes in motion. You're now a robber. Okay. That was it, man. Any questions? I had a great time talking to you guys.
What was your alignment on the hawk?
On the hawk?
Yeah.
It's 4x4. 4x4. The end-man line of scrimmage. What we can do.
So you go four and then stack them four or like how?
4 yards off, 4 yards to the outside.
Oh, okay.
What we can do with that corner, if he's going to crack by that split in a lot, we'll just turn his ass to split in. You know what I mean? We'll tilt him this way. So now we don't get that crack block anymore. So now he can force. He's still force feeling full. Everything's still hold true for him. But like, here's what I'm talking about. So let's say if we get something like this right here, okay, you gotta be able to play the quarterback like that. He's gotta be a hitman, okay? He's gotta be able to play that ball if it spills, okay? So we've got really, to the outside, we got two guys playing quarterback and pitch, hoping hopefully he can
help out
half a man.
And then your corner's going to try and take that eight away.
Right. That's tough.
Yeah.
That's the toughest play to defend for the 4-4. And that's where they'll attack you right now. They'll do that real quick, and they'll do this.
Coming back?
No. They'll walk out their tight end. If you're a 4-4 and you're playing the wing T, you're going to see this right here. Probably that was going to be about 2 to 3 yards. Okay. So what do you do versus that? We just get our stud. All right, we now put him in a 7, but we say this, right? You're working to 2 yards right behind that outside hip every play right now. They do that, they hit you in that cat, take it away, okay, right now, okay? That's all we do, okay? And say, anything coming back to you, cross shoulder. But once you do this, they won't do this anymore, okay? What you do not do is play this guy head up and have that freaking cavity, all right? All right, guys. Thank you.